And will I be able to share screen?
Yeah, so you should be able to share your screen now if you
Okay.
I've made you a co-host.
Okay.
Yep. Cool. So thanks everyone for joining today. Thanks to Baris Barchi for coming to speak to us today. Baris is a professor of in the physics department at Mersin University. In philosophy and foundation of physics, his interests are on the direction of time and on statistical mechanics generally, of which he's published extensively. And the title of the talk today, as we can see, is average work equal to KB2 natural log 2 in the Szilard engine? Thank you, Baris. I'll hand over to you.
Thank you very much. Now, I do not have a laser pointer, so I will just use my mouse. So the title is average work equal to KB2 LN2 in Szilard engine? Well, I will give you the basics. So if you can follow me, and you can stop me anytime you want. I mean, this is a really friendly gathering now. So just stop me anytime you want. I will give you all the rudiments, I believe. And then later on, I will make a U-turn and present you something I believe not perceived so far in the literature. So let us start. Szilard engine is a single molecule, is confined in a box, which is weakly interacting with the thermal bed at temperature T. And then a movable partition is inserted in the center of the box. It doesn't have to be the center, but let us assume that we are inserting it at the center. And then, depending on the location of the molecule, because when you insert the partition, the molecule could be on the left or right. Depending on the location, the partition is moved to the right or to the left. This step corresponds to the reversible isothermal expansion and hence extracts KB2 LN2 work from the environment. For those who don't know, KB is Boltzmann constant, T is temperature of the bath, heat bath, and LN2 is just LN2. And then partition is removed when it reaches at the far end of the box. And since the final snapshot is the same as the initial one, single molecule in a box in contact with the thermal heat bed. The work is reversibly extracted from the heat bed in the cycle, although the free energy difference is zero. So there's a violation of second law. Now, why is there a violation of second law? I didn't put the heat bed here, but in each figure, assume that there is a weak coupling with the heat bed. So there are always heat beds here, okay? Since initial snapshot A is the same as E, it means that it implies that you have completed the cycle. So once you have the cycle, you can talk about second law. And let us assume that we are talking about the work formulation of the second law, which means that average work has to be equal to free energy difference. Now, since initial snapshot and the final is the same, free energy difference is zero, and average work is KBT LN2 because of the isothermal reversible expansion, so that you have violated the second law because average work is not equal to the change in free energy.
Can I ask something
Sure.
before you continue, just to be sure I understand?
Sure.
Is the idea that the black parting also interact with the partition?
Okay, that's a very good question. Let us move on.
Okay.
Okay, that's a very good question.
Okay.
So, I mean, so far, I am just giving you the rudiments which can be found in the literature. So, the problem is that I didn't see anybody writing it explicitly, but how do you calculate this average work, which is KBT LN2? How? Well, one way is to use usual ordinary thermodynamics, but you cannot do that because it's a macroscopic theory. So you cannot apply thermodynamics, to the single molecule per se. So what can you do? Since thermodynamics cannot be used, what you can do is the following. Since there is a weak coupling with the thermal bed, after a while at least, the single molecule will have the canonical distribution. And then, of course, for later use, don't forget, canonical distribution means that you have only fluctuations in energy. And then partition function for a single molecule is given. You can calculate Helmholtz free energy, and then you can calculate the average work as KBT ln2. Everybody can see my pointer with the mouse, right? Okay. So you have KBT ln2, which also means that you have an entropy decrease of KB ln2. So you have an average work of KBT ln2, but you have a decrease of entropy by KB ln2. Now, as you can see here, I have to use equation of state here. And how do I know that this equation of state holds? PV times KB2. P is pressure, V is volume, KB is Boltzmann constant, T is temperature. F is Helmholtz free energy, Z is partition function. And this is thermal wavelength, lambda T. I have derived equation of state from canonical setting so that I use this mechanical formula to obtain KBT ln2. So I have referred to the canonical distribution, and canonical distribution means you have fluctuations in energy. So now, since we have seen that Sizzler's engine violates the second law because average work is not zero, but change in free energy is zero, we go on with the possible resolutions. Now, the first guy is Sizzler. I could never pronounce this name properly. I guess it's Sizzler or something in Hungarian. Sizzler came up with the fact that one can get rid of this violation of second law. One can exorcise the demon, so-called. One can refer to the information acquisition during the measurement, because in order to go ahead, continue, you have to know on which side of the molecule, on which side of the partition the molecule is located in. So before the measurement, you just know that it can be on the right or left with uniform probabilities, with 1/2. But then after the measurement, you certainly know that it is on the right or left, depending on the outcome of the measurement. Now, Sizzler never wrote explicitly about what kind of entropy he has used. But in the literature, this part is usually associated with the Shannon entropy, Shannon information measure. Therefore, and also Landauer, so therefore all this information thermodynamics connection. So if you do this, and this time, of course, I didn't use another letter, but here, S means Shannon entropy, not thermodynamic entropy anymore, okay? So if you calculate this, you have a net increase of KB ln2, which compensates the decrease of KB ln2 entropy obtained in the Sizzler engine. So when you combine them, you have net zero change of entropy, so that second law is saved. So the game here revolves around finding the missing link of this KB ln2 somehow. I mean, how can we increase the entropy by KB ln2? This is the name of the game. Why KB ln2? Because that is the entropy that you are missing out in Sizzler engine. So the main idea is Landauer principle, Now, Landauer principle is something like this. Landauer principle, the general idea is the following. Landauer principle says, instead of information acquisition, the daemon somehow should store this information, and later on, this information should be reset. Usually they say erasure, but it's in fact a resetting, so that the cycle should be complete. So demon himself or herself is part of the system. And if we are talking about the beginning and ending of the cycle, also demon itself should be restored. This is the main idea of Landauer principle. So that instead of information acquisition, now we are talking about information erasure, or more properly, resetting. So what are the steps forming the Landauer principle? This time, again, you have a molecule. It's on the right or left, but be careful. This is what happens for the daemon now, in the daemon. And then location at the left half corresponds to 0 bit, and right half as 1 bit. So 0 and 1 bits. Now we are talking in terms of information entropy. Please be careful with the switch of the terms now. And then partition is removed so that the single molecule expands into the whole volume. And this stage is called erasure. And then partition is reinserted at the right end of the box, and then you make an isothermal reversible compression. This stage is called resetting. So in the resetting stage, you have KBTLN2 work. So resetting stage is exactly the opposite of that relevant part in Sizzler engine, which is isothermal reversible expansion. And then the molecule is finally at the left half of the volume. So let us look at here again. You have either left or right. You remove the partition. This part is called resetting. And then you put the partition to the right, far right, and then you compress it. And then you have 0 bit again, because on the left it's 0 bit. So whether the idea is whether you have 1 bit or 0 bit, you always reset it to 0. And due to the part C, step C, which is called resetting, you have KB2 LN2 or an increase of entropy KB LN2, so that you save the second law. So here, be careful. It's not erasure, step B, which is responsible for KBLN2 gain. It is resetting, which is isothermal reversible compression part. Step C is responsible. And then, okay, now, unfortunately, there are many versions of Landauer principle. So I considered, in my opinion, the one of the most solid ways, I mean, is to refer to Maroni paper. I don't know exactly, but I guess he's at the University of Oxford now. I don't know. I'm not sure. But at the time he was, I guess.
He used to be at Bristol. He's now at Oxford.
He's where?
He used to be at Bristol a long time ago. He's now at Oxford.
Ah, Oxford. Okay, excellent. Thank you very much. So Owen Maroney wrote this paper in Physical Review E. In my opinion, this is as solid as it gets. I mean, I don't think one can go beyond this paper. So what does Maroney does? He does many things, but for us, what is important is the following. He comes up with this formula. I mean, of course, not comes up, but he proves this formula, to be honest. So delta SNi Here, the subscript is important. NI means non-information bearing degrees of freedom. So basically, it's the demon, let us say. So here, KB is Boltzmann constant. Delta H is Shannon entropy change when you are resetting the bit. And ln2 is ln2. So of course, you will think that this formula is everywhere, even implicit in Landauer, but I don't agree with that. And I really refer you to Owen Maroney's paper. I mean, he really makes a tour de force to come up with this formula. And he comes up with this formula in a very general setting, by the way. So then, so at the beginning, you have one or zero with uniform probabilities, but at the end, you have only zero bit with probability one, so that you have minus one bit. If I put it here for the reversible case, you will see that one, again, due to Landauer principle, KB ln2 of increase in entropy in non-information bearing degrees of freedom. Now, for physicists, these are well-known names. I'm sure Ronnie knows it. Sagawa, Ueda, these are Japanese scientists, famous for stochastic thermodynamics, etc. They have another version, which is different. I labeled as LP2, Landauer Principle 2. The general idea is the same, but here they find that they do something a little bit different. They say that when I remove this partition in step A, this is an adiabatic free expansion, an irreversible process thermodynamically. So they find the culprit as adiabatic free expansion. But this adiabatic free expansion cannot pass to the environment being simply adiabatic. So what happens? Then this entropy obtained from adiabatic free expansion is released to the environment through compressed in a single molecule. So that at step C, you pass the entropy to the environment so that you save the second law. But please be careful. Here, the main culprit is the adiabatic, irreversible free expansion when you remove this partition. Step C is only there to pass the entropy to the environment. Okay. So, yeah, this is, you can read. I mean, basically, it's what I said. Adiabatic expansion yields an entropy increase, which we need to exercise the demon coming from the Sizzler engine. But since the process is adiabatic, its entropy cannot be transferred to the environment, so that you need step C, which is isothermal reversible compression, to transfer the entropy increase to the environment. Now, Sagawa and Ueda paper is important in one important, two important aspects. Why? First, they use irreversible thermodynamic processes to exercise the demon. Second, there is no reference to information theory, nowhere. I mean, it's all about adiabatic free expansion and isothermal reversible compression. So no argument related to information entropy whatsoever. Yes, this is important. No reference to logical entropy, operation, or measurement. Now, another paper. Now, the first couple of ideas that I showed you is about how to approach Landauer principle in literature. Now, this one, and physicists will know this name, Parando, who is really famous scientist in statistical mechanics. Parando, Cavalli, and Vandenberg came up with this physical review letters paper, and hidden in the paper somewhere, they talk about how they obtained Sizzle Alert Engine. And this is a very interesting paper. I'm sure James Lademan would enjoy it. Let us see what they are doing. Now, they start with overdamped Brownian particle in a time-dependent potential. Even in philosophy of physics, we are accustomed to this figure. And then by externally manipulating the potential, you have a double well, and then you complete the cycle and you have this final snapshot, exactly the same as initial snapshot. So this is how they model the Sizzle Alert Engine. Okay, so far so good. Even in some of Norton's papers, we have seen this. But here is what they do. Please look at this equation very carefully. This part, I don't know if you see, this first equation before the arrow is their general equation. Average work minus free energy difference is equal to KBT ln P tilde divided by P. Now, in order to understand this expression, you need to know what is P tilde. Okay, now, Parando and the co-workers formulate the problem as a forward in time and backward in time manner. So they go forward with usual probabilities and then backward. And whenever they go backward, they label it as tilde. So this equation is something they obtained in general, but then they apply it to the Sizzle Alert Engine and Landauer principle. So what do they do? Here is what they do. They say, let us consider one snapshot, for example, B. Now, if you inspect the snapshot B, the molecule has the probability of being on the right or left with uniform probabilities, i.e. 1/2. So PRL regarding snapshot B is 1/2 PRL. This one is 1/2. And then you complete the cycle and you go back. You go back. Now, here is the trick. The snapshot B was having the information of being on the right or left with equal probabilities. But once I have completed the cycle and make a measurement, I know that molecule is on the right or left. So when I'm going backward, I know with probability one whether the molecule is on the right or left. So this P tilde is one. So you obtain this bound, and then they consider Landauer bound is just minus of Sizzle Alert Engine bound, and they obtain this Landauer bound. I hope you understood, because this is a very different construct. Now, so why did I take this as an example? Here is the reason. Sorry. One problem, first problem, in their formulation, one has heat bed interaction only in snapshot A. So you have thermal bed coupling in snapshot A, then you decouple the bed, you remove the heat bed, and then you have all these snapshots. And when you are going backward, you put the thermal bed again at here, and then again you remove the heat bed, and you look at the sequence of snapshots. So in Sizzle Alert Engine, we always have coupling with the heat bed. Here, it is only initially. And second problem, I didn't tell you anything about whether the process is reversible or not, whether it is reversible, quasi-static or not. I didn't tell you anything. So their formulation is independently giving these results. In fact, it's even worse. Now, let us do it in a very reversible, quasi-static way. You go like this. You are here in part B. You have 1/2 probabilities of being on the right or left. And then you go on very slowly. It takes almost infinite time. And then you go back. But now you don't have probability one when you return because you did it quasi-statistically. All information is lost. So that again, you have 1/2 probabilities. So that this formula gives you zero. If I do it exactly in the Sizzler engine manner. I mean, if I apply all the rules of Sizzler engine, this formula doesn't give me KBT LN2, but it gives me zero. If I do it in quasi-static reversible way. And that's the way Sizzler engine is done. And second problem, because the coupling is only initial with the
heat. You're okay to ask a question here.
What?
Can I ask a question?
Yes, sure.
Okay, so it just occurred to me when you go backwards, of course, you in this figure, it's more clear that there is a problem than when you do it with the partition, because you just increase, you need somehow to trap the red particle, right? In the,
yes.
In the right well, but in order to do that, you need to know where it is.
Exactly.
So, but this is not taking into account
They just say that it's due to the externally manipulated time-dependent potential. That's it.
But in order for that externally manipulated potential to work, they'll need information about the position of the particle. And of course, that also needs to go into the accountants of the...
In fact, it is even worse. I mean, in order to calculate free energy, for example, you need to have, for example, you have to calculate the free energy of snapshot B. But how will you calculate? Because there's no coupling with the heat bed here.
Right.
So, in fact, they explicitly state that the free energy differences between this guy here and backward protocol here. Because you only have coupling to the heat bed here and here. So, I mean, this example I have provided because I have provided this example because you can see that when physicists talk about Landauer principle, they even lose the connection with the real thing. I mean, okay, this is the part that I come in, let us say. Okay, so far so good. We understood what Sizzler engine is and some tactics of Landauer principle, but there is a problem. First, the piston in the Sizzler engine has to be free to move so that this single molecule should hit and move it to be able to move it, right? So the piston should be free to move. But then remember that canonical distribution means fluctuations of energy. But since due to the coupling with the heat bed, one should also take into account of the partition because volume fluctuations caused by it are of the same order, 1 divided by square root of n. And second problem, Sizzler engine implicitly assumes small fluctuations in volume. Okay, since the uncontrolled partition is part of the system, okay. I mean, so there are three problems here. One, for the particle to move the partition should be light enough. And if it is light enough, it should be bound to small fluctuations, because thermal bath is there always, all the time. Second, if you are taking energy fluctuations in the form of canonical distribution, you should also take volume fluctuations into account, because this piston has to fluctuate because they are mathematically of the same order and you do not control the piston. Piston is free to move as it wants.
Sorry, can I ask a question here?
Sure.
I'm not totally agree with you, because this piston could be easily a kind of, for example, potential that sure. Your system, this abstract piston could be, I don't know, for example, an optical the potential that receive the energy and, for example, later release it to a kind of, photon that release to that. So it's not necessarily a physical object that follows the...
Well, we also wanted to see this thing. This thing was in my mind for a long time. So we were doing another experiment with optical traps. And I have seen that even in optical traps, you see the fluctuation. There is no way to get rid of it. I mean, I don't know if you are a physicist or a philosopher, but I was involved in the experiment. The aim of the experiment was something else. But I can assure you, take my word for it, even if you do it with optical trap, fluctuation is there.
But isn't there also another fluctuation that comes in when you Barry says that it has to be so light that the molecule can move it? You think immediately of quantum fluctuations also.
Well, that part, that's something else.
Okay. But
we were doing the experiment classically. I mean, we were doing Jarzynski inequality,
mm-hmm.
and we have seen that it fluctuates, but somehow we just worked with infinite heat bed, and our aim was doing the fluctuation anyway, so it didn't cause any problem.
My point here is it this fluctuation directly relates to 1/√n that you can somehow define by the temperature of your heat bath? Because if it's, I don't object your claim. There could be any kinds of fluctuation in your barrier for infinite other reasons. But is this fluctuation is directly related to 1/√n, which is definable by the temperature of the heat bath, or no?
Well, if you wouldn't have a heat bath, you wouldn't have any fluctuation, right?
For the system, not for the barrier.
No, even the single molecule energy would be constant.
Sure. I just want to emphasize this fact that there could be, and I'm not insisting on it, there could be a kind of barrier that you can, let's say, assume there is no fluctuation related to the heat thermodynamic of the heat pack and the interaction of canonical distribution.
Well, let me clarify something. Please stop me and give me feedbacks. I mean, really, I need this, and I appreciate it. I mean, so let us make this clear. Second, what does it mean to have the single molecule to have canonical distribution? I mean, because
is it a rhetorical question or something?
No. Oh yeah, rhetorical. Yes. So you have a coupling with the bath. Bath is there. Okay, because otherwise, I don't know how to get the equation of state, because this is not, I mean, you cannot say that you get equation of state from thermodynamics, because we never use thermodynamics for single molecule. The only way to justify it is through canonical distribution, which means heat bath. And when you have heat bath, you have an uncontrolled piston. What do you expect to see? And this piston should be such that one single molecule should be able to move it. So order of magnitude in both parts is in the game. But of course, I should tell you that 1 over square root of n is important for me because in the next slide, I will do something. And in the next slide, to be able to do that, I need 1 over square root of n.
So, okay, thank you.
But thank somehow, you. I thank you. But somehow, let us be convinced for now that piston will small, of course, this is very important, small fluctuations, because there are also papers by Norton, which says that it fluctuates greatly and there is a no-go theorem, whatever. I do not buy that, okay? These are fluctuations around equilibrium. Just like energy fluctuations of usual canonical case, okay? This is very important. Let me remind you again. These are small fluctuations around average.
Thank you.
So now, I thank you, sir. So now, okay, what do you have? Now, whenever you have a piston fluctuating and thermal bath, there is already an ensemble for that. There is already a distribution for that. I mean, don't be taken away by the word ensemble. It just means that replacing canonical distribution with something else when there are small fluctuations in volume, okay? And then this thing is already known to molecular dynamics people. They always do this. This is called MPT ensemble. And I need 1 over square root of n here in order to be able to do that, in order to be able to do all these calculations. These calculations you can find in molecular simulation textbooks. You can always find it because they always use it. What do you do? Instead of, you see here, we always expand it in terms of energy when we have canonical distribution. Here, you also expand it in terms of volume. So imagine that you have Taylor expansion, but instead of one, you have two variables, energy and volume. Then you go exactly the same roadmap as the canonical distribution, but you also take into account the changes in volume. And then you have all these equations. Please don't be bothered by that. I just wrote them for completeness. And then this delta is important. You have average volume. Why do you have average volume? Because now volume is a fluctuating quantity. And you have this delta. What is delta? Delta is the partition function when you have both energy and volume fluctuates, of course, by small amounts around equilibrium. So now there is something very strange going on because of this exponent two. Equation of state has two for a single molecule in the case of Sizzler engine. And then you have entropy change, which is minus two KB ln two. I mean, it is still single molecule. Sizzler engine are just allowed both energy and volume to fluctuate around equilibrium. That's all I did. And due to my friend, there is also a simulation. This is the equation of state general expression. For single molecule, you see that you get two here. And please do not think that as n goes, because of thermodynamic limit, this becomes PVNKBT. No, this is not a matter of thermodynamic limit. This is always like that when you have volume fluctuations and energy fluctuations simultaneously. The only reason is that since the number is becoming bigger, the difference between, for example, 10,000 and 10,001 is smaller to be perceived. But it is never one. Okay? I mean, it is never... whatever the molecule size is, number of molecules is, you always have this n plus one. That is the cost of having volume fluctuations too. If you don't have volume fluctuations around the equilibrium, if you have only energy fluctuations, you have only this part without plus one. But with volume fluctuations, you have this. So now we will go all the way back. Okay. Now we have seen that somehow Dr. Ruzbe might be, his claim might be relevant. Let us put it aside. Maybe I couldn't justify it well, but let us all agree that if I also take into account the volume fluctuations around equilibrium, then I have two. Let us see. Two KBT LN2 of work in Sizzler engine. So now that in Sizzler engine, I obtained double of the ordinary bound, let us go the solutions one by one. Now, here is the information acquisition argument. Now, what can you change here in order to remedy the situation? Now, since fluctuations are small around equilibrium, I will still have uniform probabilities with epsilon. By the way, I also checked, if epsilon is small, there is no way to get to KBT LN2 by this construction. And then you have one. So one or one minus epsilon when epsilon is small, because fluctuations are small, doesn't change anything. So information acquisition doesn't work. I mean, this will still give you the usual KBT LN2. It will never give you double of that bound. So information acquisition cannot be accommodated to small volume and energy fluctuations. And then, and here in Maroni's paper, in Maroni's paper, nothing changes. I am still resetting 1 bit. Nothing changes. In fact, there's something that changes. It's even worse. Here, it is still minus 1 bit. But on the left-hand side, according to Maroni, this can be also Gibbs entropy. And if I do the calculation again with Gibbs entropy, I get 2 KBT LN2. So left-hand side gives double of the usual bound, and right-hand side gives the usual bound. So even the equality fades. Here, in this case, I don't know how to use this for my purposes, because this assumes that the culprit is irreversible free adiabatic expansion. Of course, here, isothermal reversible compression, I can consider volume fluctuations and I can get 2 KB LN2. This is very important. In this part, isothermal reversible compression, I can get 2 KB LN2. But remember that origin of this part was here, irreversible free adiabatic expansion. And irreversible free adiabatic expansion, by its very nature, means that the single molecule does not have any interaction whatsoever with the piston or partition. You suddenly remove the partition, and single molecule doesn't have time to interact with the partition. That's what we call free adiabatic expansion. So whether the partition fluctuates or not doesn't have anything to do with irreversible free adiabatic expansion. So I can make this isothermal reversible compression double, but I cannot make its source double. And here, of course, I do not even know how to begin, because the Sizzler engine is a quasi-static reversible machine. And here, for reversible quasi-static case, it gives me zero. And there is the problem with the heat bath. So I do not even know how I can resolve this issue, because the formula itself and the modeling itself is incompatible with the usual Sizzler engine and Landauer principle. So, okay, so what did we see? Small fluctuations in both volume and energy yield the novel Sizzler engine bound, which is double of the older bound. This bound seemingly cannot be explained away by the currently held strategies, because resetting stage and initial entropy source are incompatible. Information entropy cannot accommodate itself to the small volume fluctuations, which is of thermodynamic origin. And some formulations of Sizzler engine in the literature present drastic deviations from the standard Sizzler engine, so that one should handle them with care. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much for that really interesting talk.
I hope it was not boring.
No, it was great. So we'll take a 5-minute break and return, maybe just for convenience, return at 5:25. We prioritize students for questioning. So if you're a student and you'd like to ask a question first, please put Q in the chat and maybe just bracket student around just so I can tell. Then after the students, we'll go to the main lecturers and members of staff and stuff. So we'll reconvene at 25 minutes past.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I make it 25 past.